President George W. Bush, who I think this was one of the most unexpected and extraordinary gestures in history, decided that he was going to devote resources to treating HIV in Africa at a time when most of the public health community in the United States was against it. So when he did that, it sort of felt like, you know, the dog had caught the car. We were barking at the car and all of a sudden it stopped and we caught it. And the question was, now what do we do? There were billions of dollars where before we had almost nothing. And so it became much more of a focus, not on advocacy and not even really on science, but on implementation and delivery. We started talking about procurement. How are we going to procure drugs at a price that will make them affordable distributable in Africa? What about supply chain? How are we going to get the drugs from where they're made to the border and then to tiny villages? These were all questions that had been answered many times over in the private sector. There was a whole science of management that was taught in the business schools, but in healthcare, there was a remarkable resistance to thinking about issues of delivery.
We live in a very big world, full of complexities, complications, interruptions, and challenges. As we've seen in the COVID-19 pandemic, local problems in a small neighborhood can quickly connect with and affect the entire globe. The scale and scope of everything, especially our problems, is large, complex, interconnected, and often daunting.
If you're like me, you see many problems in our world that needs fixing. Poverty, COVID-19, healthcare, health equity, hunger, war. So what happens when you are given the opportunity and the resources to actually tackle a big problem? What do you do if it's you who has to save the world this time? Pretty quickly, things can feel overwhelming, right? But don't panic. Humans have done some pretty big stuff. And we've always done it by breaking things down into smaller, manageable parts.
That's where science and the skill of management come in. I am Zainab Salbi, founder of Women for Women International. In this Becoming Better Ancestors series, we are looking at public health's eradication of smallpox, the only human disease ever wiped off the face of the planet, and sharing how these 9 critical lessons can apply to global problems today. This is Lesson 7. The best decisions are based on the best science, but the best results are based on strong leadership and management. Let's go to the classroom. We are speaking with husband and wife team, Doctors Larry Brilliant and Garija Brilliant. Dr. Larry Brilliant is CEO of Pan Defense Advisory, senior advisor to the Skoll Foundation, and a CNN medical analyst. Previously, he was the president and CEO of the Skoll Global Threats Fund, vice president of Google, and the founding executive director of Google.org. Dr. Brilliant lived in India for nearly a decade, where he was a key member of the successful WHO smallpox eradication program for Southeast Asia. Dr. Garija Brilliant, who holds a PhD in public health administration, is an equal partner in many of the couple's enterprises and was also instrumental in the World Health Organization's smallpox eradication program. Together, they co-founded Seva Foundation, an NGO whose programs have given back sight to more than 5 million blind people in 24 countries.
In 1974, March, most of India had cleared smallpox. Many states had smallpox zero. Suddenly, outbreaks of smallpox appeared almost mysteriously in areas that previously were smallpox-free. Dozens of outbreaks appeared in the state of Madhya Pradesh. After a week of trying to organize the epidemic using pushpins on hand-drawn maps, a pattern emerged. Each outbreak had begun with a working-age young man who had left his house to seek work, come back to his village, and often died before he could be visited by a health professional. We assumed that he'd been somewhere looking for a job, but we didn't know where. The few who were well enough to speak when they were visited said that they had come from or traveled through the bordering state of Bihar. we soon learned that the cases were originating in Tatanagar, the steel city of India.
But Tatanagar was a company town of the corporate behemoth Tata Industries. It was not clear at all what to do in a city that had no centralized government, no public health structure, and where Tata Corporation had taken over all those roles. Tata was either unaware of, hid, or denied the epidemic. No one had ever faced a situation like this. Such an outbreak would require mass quarantine as well as search and containment on a huge scale. It would require finding every cause of smallpox and engineering a ring of immunity around it, tracing each outbreak to its source, posting watchguards, vaccinating nearly every one of the 750,000 residents of the area.
Nicole Grasset and Bill Fagey from the New Delhi office of WHO sent me to go to Tatanagar. When I reached there, I tried to find the head of the Tata Companies. I saw a railway station where there were dozens of dead bodies in caskets stacked like cords of wood. There was so much death in the city, it was terrifying. I asked around and I found out where the head of the Tata Company lived, a man named Rusi Modi, who was the CEO of the largest subsidiary of Tata's. We showed up at his house just after midnight. I pounded on his door. His caretaker opened the door and two big dogs came for me. Rusi Modi said, "Who are you and what are you doing here?" And I said, "I've come from WHO. Do you know that your Tatanagar is exporting smallpox all over the world, reinfecting India?" Rusi had no idea that smallpox was raging. And he, almost on the spot, decided that he would do something about it, and he immediately called and briefed his legendary chairman, this wonderful man, J.R.D. Tata. It was J.R.D. Tata who ran the Tata Companies. The Tata administrators gathered together and they put together a plan overnight in what they said was the Tata way. It included terms as a young 20-some-odd man I'd never heard of before. Deliverables, action items, management by objective. The outline, which included an operating plan, a budget, duties, job descriptions, responsibilities, was the most comprehensive, well-organized document I'd ever seen. We didn't have those tools in public health. On the final approval call, J.R.D. Tata said that the plan was good, and he announced that Tata would bear full financial responsibility for stopping the outbreak and the exportations. They added 50 doctors from the Tata hospitals from all over the country who arrived within 72 hours. They added 200 paramedical supervisors, 600 search workers, and 50 jeeps.
As far as containment, a separate team of vaccinators accompanied the search teams. We set up municipal vaccination centers and vaccinated at temples and mosques, local markets, and schools. Tata made sure we were staffed with sufficient searchers and vaccinators and had money to hire on the spot. The company sent dozens of top managers to the field as tactical advisors. Yet even the best management strategy would have failed in those pivotal years in India without strong leadership and delivery at every level across India. Dr. Nicole Grasset, a dear friend, comes to mind in this regard. Well, Nicole Grasset was the head of the national program to eradicate smallpox in Southeast Asia, and she was, in addition, the only woman in WHO in India at that time. She was French Swiss. She was smart, intelligent, vivacious, and very glamorous to my eye. She was always well-dressed, manicured, and incredibly poised. But behind that poise and that charm was a steel determination that allowed her to work tirelessly for the eradication of smallpox.
Effective management requires inspiring leaders. And one of the most of these inspiring leaders that we have ever met is our friend and mentor, Bill Fagey. Bill was the former head of the CDC under Presidents Carter and Reagan, recipient of the Presidential Medal of Freedom, and he's one of the most respected people in global health. He's there right now with Dr. Susmita Parashar in our classroom. In addition to being an accomplished medical figure in her own right, Dr. Parashar's career was inspired by her father-in-law, mentor, and my dear friend, Dr. Mahendra Dutta. We could not have eradicated smallpox without Dr. Dutta.
The science was clear. Surveillance and containment worked, but it was the effective management and implementation of the public health intervention that allowed the team to not just disrupt each outbreak, but ultimately to eradicate the disease.
And I'd like to mention three people that provided exceptional management and leadership. One was Dr. Nicole Grasset. She was as comfortable meeting royalty as meeting a villager. And as soft as she was tough. She never took no for an answer. I remember once when she was not getting her way with WHO and the Indian bureaucracy. So she wrote a letter to Indira Gandhi asking for help, and she got it. The second person, though, is Dr. M.I.D. Sharma. At the time of smallpox eradication, he was head of NICD, the National Institute for Communicable Diseases, the equivalent of CDC in India. And he was a very good boss. He never raised his voice. And I remember one day in a meeting when an outsider was criticizing the Indian workers for not doing something. But he let this person finish. At the end, he said, "Thank you very much. Let me remind you, this is our country." And it stopped everything. The third person was Dr. Mahendra Dutta. And you know him better than I do.
My father-in-law, and I loved him so very much.
And he also had a very calm way about him, that even in the most difficult situations, he did not become agitated. And he was a field worker. He wasn't afraid to travel. He wasn't afraid to get into villages.
Let me tell you, every time I talked to him, the main thing he talked about was smallpox program and his trips to Bihar and his working with you. And even in his last days, when his memory was fading him, he would talk about the smallpox program. I think the world is very fortunate that he worked on this program with you.
Integrity is the reason why people respected all three of those people.